Members, good morning. It's the appointed time. We have a quorum. We have four papers for discussion today. Before the meeting, the government submitted information note ECI bracket 2022-23 number 13 for circulation among members. That paper sets out the changes in the directorate establishment approved since 2002 and also the effect of these proposals on directorate establishment. A reminder to members, if you have any direct or indirect pecuniary interest in the items for discussion today, please disclose the nature of such interest under Rule 83A of the Rules of Procedure before you speak. I also draw members' attention to Rule 84 of the ROP, which governs voting on items where pecuniary interest or direct pecuniary interest is involved. The first item, EC bracket 2022-23, number 19. This is the proposed creation of 7 permanent non-civil service positions or civil service posts in the Chief Executive's Policy Unit. That is 1 D4 equivalent non-civil service position, Administrative Officer Staff Grade B1 at D4, 2 D3 equivalent non-civil service position or Administrative Officer Staff Grade B at D3, and 4 D2 or DL2 equivalent non-civil service position or Administrative Officer Staff Grade C or Principal Economist / Government Engineer / Deputy Principal Government Counsel / Government Town Planner at D2 or DL2, all these in the Chief Executive's Policy Unit, to be offset by the deletion of 7 permanent civil service posts of equivalent ranking, with immediate effect upon approval of the Finance Committee to enhance the government's capabilities in research and advocacy on long-term and strategic issues, and to report to the Chief Executive the outcomes of the related studies and analyses. Joining us for this item are some officials. The panel on public service was briefed and consulted on this item. Joining us for this item are the officials, the head of the Chief Executive's Policy Unit, Dr. Stephen Wong, Ms. Hini Lam, the deputy head of the CEPU, and also the assistant head of the CEPU, Mr. Chen Fong Ming. Mr. Kwok Wai Kar is here. Mr. Kwok, please tell us about the discussion at the panel level. Good morning, everyone. The panel on public service discussed this item at the meeting on February 20th. Members discussed the proposal about the changes to the CEPU's directorate establishment. Members believe that first, the CEPU should ensure that people they hire have the experience in policy research and policy making, and second, set performance indicators to assess the performance of the CEPU and monitor the quality of research projects. The panel supported the submission of the proposal to the establishment subcommittee. Thank you, Madam Chair. On the line of waiting to speak are some members, Mr. Chow Siu Chong, Dr. Teck Chi Yun, and Mr. Jesse Shang. 5 minutes for each member. Let's start with Mr. Chow. Thank you, Madam Chair. Some questions. In paragraph 6, item E, the CEPU will do forward-looking studies on strategic issues. When you say forward-looking, strategic and long-term issues, can you explain in more specific terms to let the public know? In specific terms, what do they mean? What are some examples? My second question, paragraph 10 in the paper, assessing public opinions. in policy making, the CEPU will use technology in gauging the public pulse. On public interaction, will more work be done by the CEPU? Will the CEPU be proactively consulting the public? Will this work be stepped up? My third question also has to do with this paragraph, that is paragraph 10. Here it says there will be a hub of advisors involving people from the academia, from business, from think tanks. There will be senior advisors and research advisors. Will these people include people from the labor sector and from the grassroots? Dr. Wong, please, the head of the CEPU. Mr. Chow indicated one area of our work, that is forward-looking research on strategic and long-term issues. As the chief executive said, during the inception of this CEPU, he cared deeply about the integration into national development. As we all know, there's a key area in our integration efforts, that is developing our city into the 8 centers. Within and beyond our current policies, there may be other areas that can help us in our efforts to develop Hong Kong into the 8 centers, so that Hong Kong can better contribute to our country's development. And also, we have to make use of the support from our country in our development. These are the areas that we will be prioritizing in our policy research. Our unit will be an in-house research unit. So in assessing public sentiment, as the paper says, we would do the conventional polling, public opinion polls, but there will be more. We will also look at the data from the social media. There will be data analytics to give us a better grasp of the public pulse. So this will be one area of our work. Finally, on the advisors we will be engaging. Now the term advisor shows up multiple times in the paper. Paragraph 9 of the paper mentions a council of advisors. The CEPU will provide secretariat support. And then in paragraph 10, the CEPU will also set up a pool of senior advisors and research advisors. We want to focus on a role as the secretariat for the Chief Executive's Council and advisors. And then as the next step, we will set up this pool of our senior advisors and research advisors. I note Mr. Chow's comment. Madam Chair, he has not addressed my point, but there are other members lining up to speak. My question was, will the pool of advisors include people from the labor sector and the grassroots? I will ask for a second round. Dr. Tik Chi Yun. Madam Chair, I speak in support of this proposal. So this is a proposal involving 7 posts that will be offset by 7 civil service posts. So this is all about using existing resources. In the other items we will discuss today, those proposals involve creation of new posts, I'm against that. But let me come back to the current proposal. I see more non-civil service posts showing up. What's the thinking behind this arrangement? There's no change to the headcount, but some posts become non-civil service posts. What's the thinking behind this proposal? The CEPU will work on the broad directions, broad policy directions, but that people care deeply about livelihood matters. What are some livelihood issues that you'll be looking at, say the needs of persons with disabilities? Will those be covered by the CEPU's research project? There will be advisors working with the CEPU. Back in the days of the Central Policy Unit or CPU, they would sit down with the paid advisors, they would do brainstorming sessions. I think that's a good way in the work. So what will be the role of these honorary advisors in the CEPU in the days to come? First, I thank Dr. Tick for his support. As he said, the head count at the directorate level for this CEPU is the same as the Policy Innovation and Coordination Unit in the last term government. So we're simply building the flexibility from the Central Policy Unit. The CPU back then had this flexibility with the directorate posts. They could get civil servants and also people outside the government involved in the research. So that they could bring in outside ideas in the thought process. My two colleagues here, the deputy head and also the assistant head, they are both civil servants. Over the past a couple of months, we worked together. Civil servants worked together with those from outside the government. They got along well. So when these people work together, they complemented the ideas raised by people from outside the government, and we managed to create synergy, and this is important. To address another point raised by Dr. Tick, in terms of the work arrangements, we have four directions: forward-looking, research on strategic issues, integrating international developments, keeping an eye on global developments, and also keeping a finger on the public pulse. Our work area depends on the kind of support the chief executive needs for his policymaking. So this will depend on the instructions from the chief executive. And then we will be looking at different areas. Now, the point about brainstorming. There used to be part-time advisors. In paragraph 10 of the paper, the advisors will be referred to as senior advisors of CEPU and research advisors. As you can tell from their names, they are part-time advisors They work on an honorary basis. As Dr. Tick was saying, they can help bring in ideas. We can pull their wisdom. In the old days, the advisors would sit together and pull their wisdom. But now, for the form of brainstorming, that we're still considering the options. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Shang Hailong. Thank you, Madam Chair. I speak in support of the CEPU forming discussions and researching into the long-term development of Hong Kong so that Hong Kong can provide better services to Hong Kong. I have four questions. We understand that towards the end of last year, there were many blueprints from different bureaus and departments. And the chief executive made his maiden policy address before that. What is the relationship between the different blueprints and your policy unit? There are different layers of consultation, some led by secretaries of departments and the chief executive himself. With the establishment of the CEPU, will you rationalize all the consultation units as well as the new Council of Advisors? Will different opinions be provided to see whether officials will accept those opinions? I'd like to also know whether you recruit talents just from Hong Kong or from all over the world. I understand that the CEPU aims at helping Hong Kong to integrate into the national development. Will you consider accepting mainland researchers or even accepting talents from the National Reform and Development Commission? Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair, Dr. Wong. Thank you, member, for your support. Our scope of work includes laying the groundwork for the next policy address. But we also aim at following up on the work in the policy address. We will coordinate these tasks. On the division of work between us and different policies and policy bureaus and departments, different bureaus will undertake policy research. Our positioning is that CEPU is an in-house research unit. Our work does not overlap the work undertaken by the bureaus and departments. But in terms of research, we want to take a step back so that we can be more forward-looking. On different issues, we want to undertake different research. On the second point, about the consultation unit, if our positioning is that we are an in-house research unit, our senior advisors and research advisors, of course, cannot replace other consultation committees. As they have their own functions and roles. For us, as an in-house research unit, for the four main directions, we want to put our heads together. on the recruitment, I will pass it to my colleague. In the CEPU, as set out in the document, we have 39 non-directorate civil servants. 18 of them are from 5 professional grades. According to their own background, there are different grades such as economist, statistical officers, etc. If need be, we will also recruit on a non-civil service basis, NCS, and we will recruit according to talents in an open recruitment format. In general, they should be personal residents of Hong Kong. If we find very suitable officers or people, we might consider those who are not permanent Hong Kong residents. Then, me myself, first of all, I speak in great support of the formulation of the CEPU. The Central Policy Unit has a long history since 1989. The leader was a very educated leader. There were different doctoral degree holders taking up different positions. Now we have Dr. Wong. In the last term government, we set up PICO, Policy Innovation and Coordination Office. Actually, it wasn't of great use. Short question and answers. Is the funding dedicated to PICO be used on the CEPU, whether of its official or official members? Are we still talking about the same funding? On the establishment, ranks and headcounts, the finances are roughly the same. Well, so they are roughly the same, but then PICO is changed to CE Policy Unit to tie in with the current term Chief Executive needs. Is that correct? Yes. Next, as our colleague asked, for the Council of Advisors, there was the Commission on Strategic Development headed by the Chief Executive with different members providing opinions. Will there be a high-level meeting joined by different senior officials? First, on the CE's Council of Advisors, as we set out in the document in paragraph 9, in paragraph 10, in the CEPU, senior researchers and research advisors are different from those mentioned in the CEPU. Well, on the strategic development, they will provide opinions to the Chief Executive of Hong Kong, such as the advantages of Hong Kong under one country, two systems, and how we can better leverage on INT, and how we can leverage on and ride on the impetus of the country for our development. It acts as a secretariat to the Chief Executive. For the senior advisors and research advisors, in terms of research, they provide opinions to us and we can better leverage think tank as an in-house think tank of the government. We do not do all these behind closed doors. Instead, we want to walk into the community. We want to tap into the wisdom and knowledge of different academics and experts in the community. So for the senior advisors and research advisors, we hope that they can play their role and make contributions to us. Do you mean in terms of research? Yes. I do not want there to be too much overlapping with other advisory committees. There are all too many advisory committees. There are 40 or so. What about Hong Kong Investment Company Limited? There are directors, etc. But then the population in Hong Kong remains the same. I hope it will be mainly on research. And Mr. Zhao Xiuchong said different policy bureaus undertake their own research, for example, on poverty, on AI computing. What I do not want to see any overlapping with other departments or bureaus. The third question has already been answered by Deputy Head. You have part-time advisors and they are remunerated. But then will there be any non-remunerated honorary or 2,000 traveling expenses? For example, those from the trade, from the finance sector, they might come and contribute. Probably you did so, Dr. Wong. Will there be such people coming to give their own opinions? First, yes, we do have, but then they are research advisors. The name is different. The associate member of the previous unit has been renamed as research advisors. The name is a little bit different, but then they are roughly the same. They help us on an involuntary basis. Well, on a voluntary basis. That is, they are honorary members. The forming directions including integration into the national development. They need to be very experienced. In an answer to Mr. Chow's question, we cover a wide scope, so we hope that our research advisors can meet different needs. Mr. Dennis Lutton. In the CEPU, there are 7 positions, but then there is no mention of the tenure. Is there any requirement of the tenure? Will it lapse after the current term government? The previous PICL is going to change into the CEPU. So what about the current existing civil servants? The government said that there will be frozen zero growth in terms of the civil service establishment. So how do you make arrangements for the number of civil servants? Dr. Wong, Deputy Head Ms. Lam will take the question on the tenure. According to the suggestion, for directorate officers, they can be civil servants and non-civil servants. If they are civil servants, of course, they will be on long-term employment basis. For non-civil servants, they will be a permanent position. So depending on the need of the non-civil servants, we will adopt a contract-based method. So what about the existing civil servants under the current suggestion? The 7 directorate officers can be taken up by both civil servants and non-civil servants. If they are taken up by non-civil servants, so the civil servants, who are usually administrative officer, will be redeployed to other positions. In terms of administrative officer, we are actually short-staffed, so they will be deployed to vacant positions. Therefore, there is no increase in the establishment. We talked about the tenure. For example, Dr. Wong's contract. How long is the tenure of Dr. Wong?
Ms. Hinny Lim, for Dr. Wong's contract, we want to get started with the work quickly. We didn't get a chance to come to electrical when the CEPU was set up. So for these non-civil service directorate posts, they are all on short-term contract. Once the Finance Committee of Electrical approves the change, and then they will be put on long-term contract instead. Normally, the term will follow the term of the current administration. Madam Chair, here's another question. These officers have their respective research areas. They should also be subject to performance standards or performance indicators. What would be done when these officers fail to meet the performance indicators? The paper also mentions senior advisors, research advisors. Will the list of these advisors be made publicly available? Will the agenda for the meetings be publicly accessible so that we electrical members can keep track of what they are up to, and for us to tell whether what they do can actually meet the needs of our countries and our city's future development? Can that be done? Dr. Stephen Wong. Thank you, Madam Chair. For our work area, we will cover the four areas we mentioned, and also we will also be coordinating the drafting of the policy address each year. We will also be keeping track of the implementation of the policy address measures. We also provide research and secretariat support for the Chief Executive's Council of Advisors. We also manage the public policy research funding scheme. Now, for the public policy funding research schemes, there are two kinds of schemes. The processes and the outcomes, if they are up to a certain standard, then we can publicize the outcomes as well. As for our in-house research, for the position of the CEPU, this is an in-house research unit. We create room for discussions for our researchers and our advisors. To do some thinking and bounce ideas off one another. Now, for the CEPU's advisors, we will publicize a list of advisors. That we're still preparing the pool, but we're currently focusing on setting up the Chief Executive's Council of Advisors. That's the priority now. Next, Mr. Stephen Ho. Thank you, Madam Chair. I support this proposal. As Madam Chair was saying, this is just about making existing resources, fixing the problem with the PICO. Back in the CPU days, they were working behind closed doors. Few in the community knew what they were doing, that is, for the CPU. Now, we have a new atmosphere. We want the government to take on board people's comments. I know the CEPU will be doing long-term thinking, but then they risk overlooking the livelihood issues at the 20th Party Congress report at the two sessions recently. There's mention of resolving Hong Kong's deep-seated tensions. Land, housing, youth issues can be taken care of by just three policy bureaus. But then when you look for land, when you create housing and you fix youth issues, there are more tensions. As Mr. Chow Siu-chung was saying, there are problems with local employment. For the fisheries sector, the fishermen are affected by reclamation projects. Of course, it's important to integrate into national development. But then local people need to integrate our own local developments. Then we cannot leave people behind. So what will be done about the people you... So what kind of people would you hire? What kinds of people will the CEPU be engaging? I haven't heard of anyone from the agricultural or fisheries sector being taken on board for the CEPU. Dr. Wong, before you were a legislative member, I mentioned issues in the agriculture and fisheries sector with you. Now I'm going to chase you up after I put you the proposals to you. These are long-term deep-seated issues. We're concerned about new sources of tension that may come up down the road. For policy research, how would you pick the topics for you to do research on? Does the chief executive give you what, tell you what to do research on, or would you listen to other people? Madam Chair, as you said, we have no shortage of advisory bodies. We have a fisheries, sustainable fisheries advisory body. Would the CEPU be looking at the minutes of those advisory bodies? We put proposals to you, but then we never heard from you. Dr. Stephen Wong. Thank you. I thank the member for his comment. Over the years, I picked up knowledge about the agriculture and fishery sector. I thought about these issues. Mr. Stephen Ho has given me many ideas over the years. Let me start by Mr. Ho's last question. On the policy research methodology. Research isn't just about getting work done behind closed doors. There are preparations, consultations, investigations, looking at meetings in the past matters. We look at legislative records, ideas raised by members. These are the key things that will be part of the research. On another point, for the CEPU is the in-house research unit. The chief executive will set the directions and also the priorities for the research. The chief executive will also give us room and the resources for the research, and also guide us in where we should be looking at. On the kind of advisors we're looking for, we're at the early stage of the preparations. I'm pleased to hear all these comments on the kind of people we should be considering. As the preparations go on, we will consider these ideas and incorporate these ideas. Next, Dr. Chow Meng Kong. Thank you. I'm from the think tank sector. I'm also a scholar in education and economics. I'm pleased to see the CEPU was set up in December last year. At the panel on public service, I said this. The CEPU is not just the brain of this chief executive, but also the brain of the SAR government. I support this proposal. I agree with the point you raised, Madam Chair. you said that we were fixing a problem of Pico. Pico usurped the functions of the CPU and descended into the secretariat of the chief executive. Now we are setting up the brain, a think tank for the chief executive. That's how we can create stronger impetus for growth. Now, my questions. It's roughly 3 months since the inception of the CEPU. Can they tell us what has been done and what are some areas they are looking at? And for this year, how many research projects or public opinion polls will be done? Are these projects undertaken by the CEPU or will they be contracted out? Different people may join the CEPU as advisors. My focus is, how will the CEPU mobilize the think tank sector so that the government can move with the times and cope with these rapidly changing times? How can the government achieve this? Dr. Wong? Thank you. I thank the member for his support. On the first point, we have conducted research on the four areas I mentioned. As we kickstarted the work, one key task is to hire people, so that we have enough people doing the research. We're still building up the team. Hiring is going on. We started the work on the four areas. On the public pulse, we conducted polls. I will elaborate on that in just a bit. On keeping an eye on global developments, we have some ideas about the 8 centers integrating international development for the Greater Bay Area's development. There may be some pilot schemes. So these are some topics that we will continue to look into. On public sentiment, we want to have the capacity to analyze public pulse. We will also commission outside parties to collaborate on the analysis. On the third point, as Dr. Chow was saying, over the past few months, we attended a function involving think tanks. We discussed some recent publications from think tanks. We looked into those publications. We are the chief executive's in-house research unit. I call it a think tank of think tanks. Since I come from the think tank sector myself, and I know Dr. Chow has his own think tank, I want to incorporate what they have, and we want to compare notes so that we can come up with better policies. Madam Chair, one more comment. The CEPU needs to set up its own website quickly. The CPU was easily accessible back in the days. Some are saying that they're not aware of the CEPU's development, so you need the website quickly. Next, Mr. Brave Chen.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I speak in support of the paper and the proposal. I'd like to mention a point. Hong Kong has been focusing on ourselves. The important speech on the 1st of July and the two sessions, the framework is global. It adopts a macro perspective. We talk about the development of Hong Kong in order for Hong Kong to thrive. We study the country and the internal circulation. We need to think it through. So we need to identify appropriate talents and officials, and we need to attach greater importance to it. We have a great spectrum of talents, but we need to focus on this area, especially when the chief executive is leading different delegates to communicate with the central government. The faster we can do it, the faster we can revive the economy. And this is the main requirement. This is how we should carry on. Thank you, Mr. Chen. Thank you, Madam Chair. When we need to integrate into the national development, and this is our research main area, as we can observe from the two sessions, Mr. Chen also took part in the two sessions. And these are important research materials. As Mr. Chen said, we need to take a step back to be more forward-thinking and forward-looking to see how we can better leverage on the distinct advantages of Hong Kong and how we can make contributions to the country so that we can improve the impetus for growth for Hong Kong. No follow-up? No. Next, Professor Chen. Thank you, Madam Chair. I speak in support of the CEPU. This can help Hong Kong create impetus for growth. I'd like to follow up on two main points. While I understand strategic research results can hardly be quantified, I'd like to ask how we can assess and take stock of the duties of the CEPU. Will we have KPIs, for example, the number of research the CEPU needs to undertake? Will the CEPU report to the Legislative Council? If yes, how will this be done? On the 20th of December 2017, for the panel on Establishment Subcommittee, a paper, the director of PICO was not only responsible for research support, but he would also be responsible for coordination among different policy bureaus and departments. He took part in cross-departmental research as well as supported the formulation of policies. But then the CEPU focuses on research and less on collaboration. There is no collaboration among departments. Does it mean that different departments work on their own for cross-departmental research? Will the CEPU collaborate with other departments and coordinate with other departments so that the most appropriate policies will be opinions on different policies will be given to the chief executive? If yes, how will this be done? Deputy Head Ms. Lam will take the question first. Thank you, member, for your question. As the head said, we have a wide spectrum of duties in the CEPU. Apart from the task given by the chief executive, we need to take stock of the international relations and landscape. We need to take the public pulse. We need to integrate into the national development. We also need to coordinate efforts to compile the next policy address. We also need to monitor different departments' progress. We also need to provide secretariat support and manage the two research funding schemes for public policies. So the CEPU has very clear tasks and missions. But because some of our work has to do with in-house advocacy or internal evaluation, it is not that easy for us to make public our results or work. On an annual basis, the chief executive delivers his policy address, and these are very pragmatic tasks that we do. The two public policy research funding schemes are the other two examples. For work results we can make public, we will make public these results as far as practicable. For example, the information that can be made public in the public policy research funding scheme, we will make announcements or make public these results online. But it might not be that convenient or appropriate for us to make public the results of a public polls. But we will tap into the wisdom and knowledge of different scholars, advisors, and the community. Also those outside the pool of advisors, including other stakeholders. This line of work can be seen by the public. Our nature of work might not have very clear KPIs, but then our work is still transparent. The community, including the Legislative Council, can see our results, can see our work. So our work performance can be objectively monitored. Professor Chen also asked about another question. Indeed, our positioning is different from the former PICO. As Madam Chair and Mr. Chow said, our positioning is that we are an in-house public policy research body. As a research body, during research, naturally we will engage the public and invite their participation. Concretely speaking, for example, if we need to coordinate the formulation of the policy address with different bureaucrats and departments, we have very close collaboration. Next, Dr. Lo Wai Kwok. Thank you, Madam Chair. Once again, I congratulate Dr. Wong on taking up this very important position. I believe that the public has expectations on the newly formed CEPU. Comparing the CEPU with the former PICO, I believe that the public will want to see more pragmatic results of the CEPU. The work needs to stay in touch with the reality. The public wants to see improvements on the deficiency of policies. The public wants to see the results. if I may be bold to say so. The head might be considered a senior commentator. With all due respect to Mr. Lau, well, Dr. Lau Siu-kai, the public might think that what he's doing is out of touch with reality. With the former pickle, we scratched our heads. We do not know what innovative has materialized. We want to see results. We are not toning down their contributions. We are not denying their results. But then for the newly formed CEPU, this can be an inspiration. That is how we can make the public feel that this unit does exist and deliver results that are made public to the community. So what about your communication with the Legislative Council? I'd like to hear from you as well. There is no increase in the number of positions, as some positions have been offset. But I think that because the former PICO has a similar establishment when it comes to directorate level, the number of directorate officers is actually similar. The head can be taken up by non-civil servants, but then it was taken up by administrative officer. For deputy heads, they were taken up by civil servants as well. Right now, you will engage non-civil servants, and that means that you have recruitment despite zero growth in establishment. So the expenditure will actually increase despite no growth in establishment. Well, I think the public money is worth it if we can fare well in the tasks. So what about the supporting officers to the PICO? Were they dismissed? Or were they sent to different departments? Is the establishment still similar in this sense? Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Dr. Low. As the chief executive always said, we can always strive to be better. We always remind ourselves of making improvements, to undertake more solid research. A lot of Legislative Council members are experts in their own field. They are experts of the experts. So collaboration and interaction are necessary, and they should be targeted. Based on policy considerations, we want to provide different opinions for reference to the chief executive. For the second question, I will pass it to Deputy Head Ms. Lam. On the directorate level, the head count is actually the same, apart from the head. Well, I can put it this way, there are a total of 8 directorate officers, with the biggest difference being that apart from the position of the head, the remaining 7 deputy or assistant heads were taken up by civil servants, and our change this time is that we can recruit non-civil servants. If the positions are taken up by non-civil servants, the original civil servant will not incur any additional expenditure. We have 3 deputy heads, and we have 1 civil servant For the remaining two deputy heads, we have recruited non-civil servants. In terms of assistant head, we have two assistant heads. They have already reported for duty, one civil servant and the other not civil servant. So in terms of expenditure, there is no change.
For those from non-civil service, there are 39 non-civil service posts. So the headcount remains 39. So that is the non-directorate. So this is the non-directorate civil service post. 39 is the headcount. Mr. Benson Lok speaking for the first round. Mr. Robert Lee, Mr. Gary Chen, and Mr. Chu Kwok Kong. And then I will speak for the second round. Does any other member wish to speak for the second round or the first round? I need to draw a line. Now we have spent an hour discussing this item. Does any other member wish to speak? Then I will draw the line here. Mr. Benson Lok, please, speaking for the first round. Thank you, Madam Chair. I speak in support of this proposal in terms of setting up the CEPU and hiring people to do the work. We had the CEPU, which kept a finger on the public pulse and also did the policy research. Then the last term government set up the PICO in place of the CEPU. The CPU, or rather the PICO, started off having hired 20 or 30 outsiders as advisors. I wrote OPAD pieces on that situation. Young people were hired to do the research for PICO. They shouldn't be just asked to do research. They should also take part to facilitate engagement. But that did not happen. And that did little to help the government keep a finger on the public pulse in this new era when young people thrive, Hong Kong prospers. So my question is, for the CEPU, apart from hiring people from outside the government and civil servants, will young people be hired as members of the pool of advisors? And will there be KPI on the share of young people among the advisors for the CEPU? And what do the CEPU do in terms of keeping a pulse on young people for the chief executive? Dr. Wong? I thank Mr. Lok for his support. On young people, getting young people to help and doing research on youth issues. As Mr. Lok knows, for research purposes, we want to cover everything. We just wrapped up a round of open recruitment for assistant researchers and researchers. For assistant researchers in particular, we are hiring younger people. As you know, as the member know, I'm from a think tank. There are young people in the think tank. For those in research in particular, it takes experience and wisdom, both matter. But then age should not be a barrier and not a constraint in quality research. So in research work, there are people from different age groups. As long as the people are passionate about research, we want to engage them, we want to get them on board. On research advisors, a number of members asked about the composition of the Chief Executive's Council of Advisors. We note members' comment. As we prepare the establishment of this council, we will try to incorporate the helpful comments from members. Next, Mr. Robert Lee. Thank you, Madam Chair. I speak in support of the proposal. My question is, for consultations and research in the future, what will be done to balance the different ideas and arguments? Especially in terms of trying to take on board the comments from a wide spectrum of comments. What kinds of questions will be asked? What kinds of when you ask a particular group of people, you get certain answers. The researchers should be impartial and be neutral. You get the answer from the kind of people you hire. So the direction is to integrate international development and pursue the goal of the 8 centers. We had silver bonds. Only certain financial institutions got to take part in it. Or the same story with the cross-boundary Wealth Connect. First, the silver bond involved banks, but there are also financial intermediaries. They can take part or take the cross-boundary Wealth Connect. Only a small number of players in the industry got to take part. So for policy consultations and research in the future, how will the CEPU ensure you actually cover, you actually do an extensive research or consultation? Or, and how do you avoid getting the kind of preconceived positions in the answers you get? I note Mr. Lee's comment. First, our role. We take a step back and take a long-term view and look at the macro matters so that we can cover a wider range of matters. And there's also intellectual honesty in what we do. We will be impartial and balanced in our thought process. We take into account a full range of facts and factors. We are an in-house research unit. We have both the room and the flexibility in our thought process. We listen to ideas from various sectors because that's what it takes to produce good research. We had a dialogue in the past, and we certainly understand some of the concerns raised by Mr. Lee. And that's also the basis on which we will take forward our work. Next, Mr. Gary Chan. Thank you, Madam Chair. The CEPU will play two key roles. First, deep analysis of the mainland policies and also global development. That's first. And then the second, looking into the long-term policies for Hong Kong. The work will help speed up Hong Kong's integration into national development. at the operational level, what will it take to help the CEPU play an effective role? There's criticism that the government commissioned research studies and then disregarded the outcomes. The government simply sticks to its old ways in policy making. So can Dr. Wong tell us what can he do to ensure that the policy bureaus and departments can actually take on board Dr. Wong's research, which involves a huge amount of resources, instead of just disregarding the research outcomes? And what would be a good timing to let the policy bureaus know what's going on in the mainland and overseas? The policy bureaus may tell you that they are at a later stage in policy making, the research comes in too late. How will these goals of the CEPU be reflected in the policies made by the bureaus? I thank Mr. Chen's reminder. We do in-house research. To give information of reference value to the chief executive. Bureaus take forward policies. They have their considerations. We want to take a step back, take the bird's eye view, and also look at the long-term issues. Our goal is to strive for quality research outcomes. By quality outcomes, I'm thinking about outcomes that take into account the considerations that bureaus have. We want to put heads together around issues. We want to look for ways to overcome the current constraints and identify good policy directions. That's a goal for our research. Over the past few months, I saw room for healthy interactions among colleagues. We could incorporate good ideas from different sides and offer alternative advice. We can provide alternative perspectives for policy making. Next, Mr. Chu Kwok-Kong. For Hong Kong's long-term development, the CEPU will play a key role. I think it makes sense to have this proposal. This proposal involves offsetting the increase in posts by deleting existing civil service posts. I hope the government can always prioritize redeploying existing resources instead of proposing an increase in the establishment. There's been a lack in a blueprint for the education sector. Would the government set up a dedicated research unit to look at the long-term policies and goals for education? our country has done great work on the equality of education. Can we learn from that? We should also look into the population-related needs so that we can plan our education accordingly and meet our future manpower needs. In proposing these posts, will the CEPU consider these issues I just mentioned?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Mr. Zhu's support. As Mr. Zhu said, our proposal is to create flexibility in the recruitment of non-civil servants. So the establishment is exactly the same as the previous PICL. There is no extra funding proposal. For the second question, I have noted Mr. Zhu's concern about education, that is, the importance of education. And I also appreciate the need of some research in Hong Kong. As the in-house research body for the chief executive, while I was answering another LegCo member, as I said, I hope for different policy portfolios, I hope to interact with different members, such as Mr. Zhu, to take forward different tasks. For the concrete scope of work, we need to lay the groundwork for the policy address. We also need to collaborate with other departments and bureaus in different policy portfolios. We will give precedence to the four major directions mentioned by the chief executive and the work arranged by the chief executive. We will take forward these tasks at full steam. I do not see any long-term target in terms of education. There are blueprints. Whenever a policy is out, there will be a blueprint, but then we lack long-term and medium-term policy planning. Mr. Tong Li-Tie, like other members, I speak in support of the establishment of the CEPU. Especially when it comes to how the Hong Kong government can advocate the relevant policies. The unit will provide research support and analysis on the dynamics and the impetus in the country. We look forward to more data and forward-looking research. There are different concerns as mentioned by members. After a period of time in the formation of the units, how can the general public or LegCo members assess whether you have already fulfilled your responsibilities well? Well, I hope to give Dr. Wong more time on this question. Basically, you are held accountable to the chief executive, but then public money is involved as well. So probably Dr. Wong can give us a succinct reply. I will go first, followed by Ms. Lam. Thank you, member, for your support. As Mr. Tse said, our positioning is it as an in-house research body for the chief executive. As I understand, in the executive, they have their own establishment in the executive, and they also have their own evaluations on their work. Based on a solid research, we want to be able to provide to the chief executive and other bureaucrats and departments ideas of value, as we will take a step back and we will adopt a forward-thinking approach in order to integrate into the national development. Based on the research results and assessment, we will think them over and provide information of reference and value to the chief executive. Ms. Lam, please. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, member. The nature of work of the CEPU, some of our work cannot be made public. We help the chief executive to prepare for the policy address and the implementation of the policies. We also provide secretariat support and research support to the Council of Advisors. These are information that we can make public to the community, and these are results that the public can see. As I heard from members, on the website of the CEPU, can we make public information? Well, we actually already have a website. If members said that they could not find a website, we will then see whether we can better use the information channels to enable the public and Legislative Council members to monitor our work. Simply put, as the head of the CEPU said, we are responsible to the chief executive himself. We are his in-house research body. We help them. Well, we help the chief executive to formulate long-term policies. We want to tie in with the four major directions, as mentioned by the chief executive. And these are exactly the yardsticks to assess our work. Madam Chair, if possible, if it's possible, I hope that the information of the CEPU can be made public to a certain degree. Let me put it this way. Not every work of other departments or bureaus can be linked to your own. I have two simple questions for myself. For PICO of the previous government, it engaged quite a lot of young people, but then there was a brain drain. With the CEPU of the current Trump government, do you think the same problem will happen? And how do you make sure that talents will not leave? Do you think a similar problem will transpire? Thank you, Madam Chair. As a leader of a unit, on the one hand, I hope to bring in the best talents, especially young people. Through young people, not only can they make contributions, but we can also nurture these young talents. When it comes to public policy research, so that in the community, we will have yet another batch of people, young people who are passionate about public policy research. Let my work in the think tank. Some colleagues did stay for a very long time. But for some colleagues, they stay for only a short period of time. By and large, if these colleagues think that they can acquire new knowledge in this position, I hope that I can provide this working environment for them. I will do my level best, not only for them to make contributions, but for them to personally grow, which will be conducive to the development of our unit as well. So that we want to bring in, nurture, and retain these talents. For talents who wish to leave, I hope they will only be in the minority. And we hope to build a pool of public research talents if we can forge a desirable working environment for them to make contributions and to grow personally. In this healthy environment, we hope to do our level best to work with these talents for the good of the community and Hong Kong. Well, I have 1 minute left. I agree with paragraph 10, assessing public opinions. You should do more data analytics online. I support this. Actually, public opinion polls over the telephone is outdated. Otherwise, there is selection bias. For online data analytics, for reclamation, for example, the Development Bureau. Netizens may have different views. Can you share the data analytics with the public as well as the Legislative Council? Thank you, Madam Chair. As Madam Chair said, apart from traditional public opinion polls, we hope to undertake more research and studies, such as data analytics on social media and on the internet. Probably we haven't mentioned in the paper, we want to do more on focus groups, such as discussions with different focus groups. We will take the local polls for the chief executive and provide opinion or information for his reference. We will decide at a later stage in due course. What is appropriate to be circulated internally and what is suitable to be made public, we will decide at a later stage. I now put this motion to a vote. Dr. Tik Chi Yun and Mr. Michael Tin are not members of these establishment subcommittees, so you cannot vote. For those in favor of EC 2022 to 2319, please raise your hand. All agree. All in favor. For those against, please raise your hand. None against. I declare this motion passed. We need to put another matter to a vote whether we will recommend further discussion of this item to the Finance Committee. We will put this to a vote. Members, please note that in accordance with Rule Paragraph 2 of the Establishment Committee, members need to make recommendations whether there should be further discussion of EC 2022 to 2319 in the Finance Committee. Now, in accordance with paragraph 48 of the Establishment Subcommittee Rule, I put the following motion to a vote. This subcommittee recommends the Finance Committee to further discuss the motion passed by EC 2022 to 2319. I remind members, should this motion be passed, that means the Establishment Subcommittee recommends the Finance Committee to further discuss this paper. If this motion is negative, it means the Establishment Subcommittee does not recommend the Finance Committee to further discuss this paper. For those in favor, please raise your hand. No one in favor. For those against, please raise your hand. A lot of them, well, a lot of us in against. Well, I think that the number of members against outnumbers those in favor. I declare this negative. Now, on to the next agenda item.
This is EC bracket 2022-23 and number 20, an item from the Labor and Welfare Bureau. This is a proposed creation of two supernumerary posts. One administrative officer staff grade B1 at D4 for 5 years, and a senior principal executive officer at D2 for 3 years, with immediate effect upon approval of the Finance Committee, and creation of two non-civil service positions of one director equivalent to the rank of D4 and one consultant equivalent to the rank of D2 for 3 years, within 6 months from the date of approval by the Finance Committee, to oversee, coordinate, and implement the manpower related policy and talent attraction work. The government, at a joint meeting this year, consulted the panel on welfare services and the panel on manpower. Joining us are the government officials, Mr. Chris Sun, Secretary for Labor and Welfare, Ms. Angelina Kwan, Deputy Secretary for Labor and Welfare, Manpower Special Duty. Mr. Bill Tang is not here. He's not a member of this subcommittee, so I will briefly go over the gist of discussion at the panel level. The panel on welfare services and the manpower panel had a meeting on February 13th this year. Members discussed a proposal of the government. It's a proposal from the LWB and the Office of the Government Economist to create six supernumerary directorate posts. The government stated that after the government restructuring, the post holders of these posts will be tasked with human resources planning, attracting talent, and also targeted poverty alleviation, and also work on welfare policy making. Members generally supported the government in stepping up the work, but raised a number of concerns, including whether the manpower forecast or projection of the LWB would overlap with the similar exercises of other bureaus and departments, and ways to improve the work of the LWB. Members argue that the government should ensure more prudent use of public money. This meant the internal redeployment of resources and manpower to meet the workload. Key performance indicators should be set to assess the work of the officials involved. The government said one of the tasks of the LWB was to plan and coordinate Hong Kong's overall manpower policy and then take a macro perspective in during a projection covering various sectors and job types, and also bring in suitable outside talent and help various sectors capture the emerging opportunities in the market. The government would refine the poverty alleviation strategy to identify target groups to make sure the resources would go to those most in need. The government, considering that the work was complex and came with immense policy significance, concluded there was a need to create the post. Members agree that the government should submit two separate proposals, one on manpower and another on poverty alleviation. The proposals would go to the establishment subcommittee for consideration one by one. Members asked for supplementary information such as the job duties of those posts and their work goals and expected outcomes in the next 3 to 5 years. The government was also asked to explain whether there would be key performance indicators to help measure the performance of the officials involved. Supplementary information was sent to the members of the two panels in paper CB bracket 2215/2023 on March 14th, the papers were also copied to other legal members. So now, members, please press the button. We have 6 members lining up, and then followed by me. I'll read out their names: Dr. Tik Chi Yu, Mr. Michael Tin, Mr. Chao Siu Chong, Dr. Lo Wai Kwong, Mr. Jesse Shang, Mr. Tang Fei, followed by me. 5 minutes each. Dr. Tik, please. Madam Chair, we just talked about the proposal about the Chief Executive's Policy Unit. I support that proposal because that proposal involves no increase in expenditure. Now, for this proposal, though, we're talking about 4 supernumerary posts, and then for poverty relief, another item, we will see 2 posts. And then for the Commissioner for Chinese Medicine Development, there will be another another directorate post. So 7 additional posts in total. Several bureaus are saying they are doing more work, so they need more directorate posts. I'm against this. The Financial Secretary, in paragraph 192 of his budget, said that there would be 0 growth in the civil service establishment to meet future challenges. But then I think there's a trick here. In non-civil service, but there is growth in the I think there's a trick being played with the concept of no change in the civil service establishment. The new term government pledged to boost efficiency of its work. We thought the civil servants would be taking on more work, but in the end, it's the public who will pick up the bill. The Financial Secretary announced cutbacks on social welfare and asked us to ride out the tough times together. So the Secretary for Labor and Welfare, can you ride out the tough times with the public? This means redeploying your existing resources to meet the need. The point about maintaining no growth in the civil service establishment is important. So can the Civil Service Bureau tell us, how are you achieving this zero growth, given all these proposals to create posts? The Financial Secretary announced controlling the growth of a civil service establishment. It will maintain the establishment at 197,000 posts, meaning no growth in the number of posts. But zero growth does not mean status quo for every single department. Some departments may have a need. Say there is an increase in workload. The proposal goes to the Civil Service Bureau, the Financial Services and Treasury Bureau. The government looks at the need. So approval is given for that department to increase the or expand their establishment. But at the same time, other posts are deleted. There are time-limited posts that are deleted or not renewed because the work has been done. So overall, there is zero growth in the establishment. Deputy Secretary, one more question. You said there is no change in the number in the establishment. But would you be, say, creating an administrative officer's post while deleting an office assistant's post? This means you create a high-paying post and delete the low-paying post. Madam Chair, we don't look at posts in particular. We look at the establishment as a whole. So the same treatment is given to both professional grades and other general grades. A time-limited post may no longer be renewed. We work with the FSTB in ensuring zero growth in the establishment. So for the Secretary for Labor and Welfare, can you meet the need with your existing resources? Let me start with the cutback of 1% in social welfare. What the Financial Secretary announced covers all sectors. The Labor and Welfare Bureau is part of the government. The Social Welfare Department and the Labor Department, we have made that 1% cutback. Subvented organizations are subject to the same treatment. The second question was whether the LWB can meet the workload with our existing resources. We thought about this long and hard. We have redeployed the resources where possible. Last July, there was a restructuring exercise. This led to a steep increase in the LWB's workload. We have to coordinate all the manpower-related work and all poverty alleviation work also fell on the LWB's shoulders. We're proposing four-time limited posts to meet the steeply increasing workload. The policy address identified talent attraction as a priority. We have exhausted all our resources and then we still see a gap, so we come up with this proposal. Mr. Michael Tin. The Secretary was at a meeting of the joint meeting involving the panel on manpower and the panel on welfare services. This post is there to attract talent, but there's a question of which comes first, talent or the post. Let's look at the latest developments across the globe. Whether we have the competitive edge, and then we think about the policies, how to get businesses to come. We need to be proactive in this global scramble in developing new industries. We cannot be the same passive player as we were in the past. I'm pleased to see there's this part in the paper. There's a change that incorporates the suggestion from Roundtable. Leading a professional team in the framework for the projection, in formulating a forward-looking and feasible proposal. How will the government ensure the projection will be forward-looking and also feasible? Does this mean we are trying to come in where other places are falling short to get people to come? Now, how do we ensure what we propose will be feasible? The Roundtable believes there are several key areas. First, artificial intelligence. Second, virtual assets. This is closely linked to our role as a financial hub. Third, renewable energy. Zero emissions will be key in the future. I also talked about ChatGPT in the past. The ChatGPT is a very powerful tool. It's like interacting with a fellow human being. We should do something. This means getting talent to come, talent who knows these areas. You will need someone with a very special background. You need someone alert to the global trends, specifically the three areas I mentioned. You also need someone who can compete with other places. That's no mean feat. We may not have such people in Hong Kong. We may have to look overseas. Maybe there is someone like that in the universities, But how would the government ensure you can get hold of someone like that? Someone with enough foresight who can say where Hong Kong should be working towards. You may not have that kind of talent inside the civil service who is so attuned to global trends.
Secretary, thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Mr. Tin. After the joint meeting last time, in a paper, we have taken on board views from the members. We need to be more forward-thinking, but then it needs to be pragmatic when it comes to the implementation of the policies. These should be our principles. As Mr. Tin said, we need to pay heed to the development need of Hong Kong, such as artificial intelligence, virtual access, as well as renewable energy. In our discussion with the trade, ESG is also lacking, which is not confined to finance. A lot of RAMs also need to work on this, information technology as well. From different levels, there is a lack of talents as well. But in order to promote economic development, we need to work on information technology. In terms of Hong Kong talent engaged to director position, it is impossible for the director to know all the things required. This position holder will not be a civil servant or a former civil servant. Ideally, if this person has a wealth of experience in marketing, etc., then this will stand them in good stead. There are experts in universities and in the council. We want to redeploy resources to fare well in this regard. Next, Mr. Chow Siu-chung. Thank you, Madam Chair. Last year, after the restructuring of the government, it was decided that the Chief Secretary for Administration's Office would be transferred to the Labor and Welfare Bureau. Different policy portfolios were transferred to the LWB, and I agree that the LWB should have enough manpower to follow up on the relevant work. So in principle, I support this proposal, but then I'd like to delve into a number of topics with the Secretary. There were hiccups in the talent attraction scheme. Was there any loopholes or oversight in terms of monitoring to prevent abuse and bolster monitoring? We didn't see any efforts. Should you step up your efforts in this connection, given the large scale of the talent attraction scheme? Without monitoring, it is easy for problems to occur. In paragraph 19 of the paper, you will set a KPI for talent attraction, and you will at least admit 35,000 talents annually. The labor participation rate of Hong Kong is very low. Last year, it was 58.3%, comparing with neighboring regions, such as the West. It is still very low. Take Singapore, for example, 70% Macau, 68.5%. In the US, it was 62%. The labor participation rate among women is even lower. Should we set a KPI in terms of boosting the local labor participation rate? For example, we need to set a KPI for raising 2% of the local labor participation rate, and then the whole government can collaborate and can work hands in hand to boost the labor participation rate. 2% equals 70,000 workers. So, Secretary, you should give it some thought. Now that you have a team, we should work more on this. Thank you, Mr. Chao Siu-chung. And thank you for your support as well. When we roll out new talent attraction schemes and when we refine the current schemes, we agree that gatekeeping is very important. For example, Top Talent Pass, we have put in place for 2 months or so. We have already made refinements, especially for issues of concern to the public. We need to be fast, but then we also need to do it in a sound manner on the local labor participation rate. Mr. Chao made a good point, especially for the labor participation rate among women. It is lower than 50% right now. We want to work more in this regard. After all, the local labor participation rate is our route on targeted poverty alleviation. We think that it is effective to release the labor force of women. We want to work more in this connection so that grassroots women will be able to take up freelance work, for example, and then they will become full-time workers in the community. I do not object to attracting high-level talents into Hong Kong in order to take forward the development of Hong Kong. But then we are concerned that the talents attracted to Hong Kong, we already have such talents in Hong Kong, and if we attract talents at a low cost, then they will drive away the local talents. The local talents will lose their jobs. You have a labor department, and you have a good grasp of the local labor market. So should you be a good gatekeeper for these measures? We have been keeping this in view. When talents come to Hong Kong for every 2 to 3 years, when they renew their visas, we need to see whether the jobs tally with their educational qualifications. For example, the immigration department would not approve the visa if a very well-educated talent comes to Hong Kong to take up a very low-level job. There are 4 members in a queue. We may not be able to finish this item, but I will anyway extend the meeting by 15 minutes to allow the members in the line to ask questions first. Dr. Lo Wai Kwok. Thank you, Madam Chair. First of all, I speak in support of the proposal of the creation of positions. As a matter of fact, the local labor participation rate has been on a decrease. For 24 months, there was a drop of $140,000. Hong Kong is on the path to normality, but then different trades and sectors have been hard hit by the epidemic. On Nathan Road, there are a large number of vacant stores. Against this backdrop, the unemployment rate has dropped to 3.4%. Economically, this unemployment rate will be seen to be full employment in the city. For manpower projections, a detailed study and research was undertaken. These are the results. Comparing 2023 and 2017, the skilled labor is 10,000 short. For 2027, 40,000 short. In 2023, 3,500 short, and it will rise to 8,500 short in 2027. From 4,000 to 65,000. These are very detailed and scientific methods of projections. These are the projections for different trades. if we do not proactively think how we can solve the problem of a lack of talents for the future development of Hong Kong or the improvement of the livelihood of Hong Kong, such as the construction of public housing in Hong Kong, we will face a very serious problem. For different sectors, such as healthcare and elderly care, the lack of talents is an undisputed fact. An important way for Hong Kong to develop from a small fishing village to an international metropolis, we need to bring in our local talents, we need to work together to reach where we are now. A metropolis. We are now facing an extremely low labor mobility rate. If we do not think how we can improve the situation, then Hong Kong is doomed as our citizens. The government is very slow in this regard. I have mentioned many times, we are trying to construct public houses to solve problems in the community, but then we also need a complete forward-looking population policy and a response from the Secretary. Thank you, Madam Chair. Thank you, Dr. Low. As Dr. Low said, for the lack of talents, indeed, it restricted our economic revival and our economic development exactly because of this. As the chief executive said, we have to be proactive in trawling for talents. So, be it the policy support measures or other aspects, we also need to accord precedence to trawling for talents. This is our major direction. We are already working on trawling for talents in view of the lack of local workers. We hope to solve this problem soon. Mr. Chang Hailong, thank you, Madam Chair. I support the creation of the positions, and I hope that we can expedite the process. There are always reasons for the creation of positions. For example, manpower planning was under another bureau. It has now been transferred to the Labor and Welfare Bureau. Hong Kong has been trawling for different talents through the top talent pass. If we do not have a dedicated team to be responsible for this, then this will hamper the development of Hong Kong trawling for talents. That is why I support this proposal. I have already read through the document, and there are points that require clarification. On the application of technology, I support Mr. Michael Tien. Well, I echo him. In paragraph 25, we have already have a website. Honestly, website is not as good as application. An application is not as good as ChatGPT. So we cannot just increase manpower, but then we have to make better use of technologies to improve the quality of labor. Through Top Talent Pass, we attract top talent, and there will be AI talents. Between paragraphs 27 and 28, I appreciate the fact that the director is from the commercial sector and the 30 out to 40 positions. Can we make it clear? We will select a portion of officer to be responsible for the top talent pass. This is my recommendation. For
paragraph 19. the KPI about attracting 35,000 talents each year. That's the KPI. And we want them to stay here in Hong Kong for at least 12 months. But is that inconsistent with what the immigration department is saying? So by this standard, these talents cannot leave Hong Kong. They cannot go on overseas trips. Can you tell us more, Secretary, please? Thank you. Mr. Shang made a great point. We want to make better use of technology. But as we just kickstarted work, we have limited manpower. So we start with this web page, and we will do more down the road. Some members proposed the use of ChatGPT in the work related to talent engagement. We will look into that. The second point, getting talents who come here involved in our work. Certainly, we will as for the KPI in paragraph 19, we need them to stay here for at least 12 months among the 35,000 people who come here. That's a way for us to hold ourselves to a standard. We want to get people here and they have to stay, and we want them to stay here. We're not making people stay here. Of course, people are free to come and go, but we hold ourselves to a higher standard. If we are simply getting people to come here and they stay for a short while, we don't count that as job done. So that means we focus on the 35,000 people who stay here for at least 12 months. But does that mean that the real number, that is the real number of people who come here, may be higher? It's just that some people choose to stay for a shorter period. So we're saying that for people who come here but stay for less than 12 months, we do not count that towards our KPI. Secretary, you're saying for no less than 12 months in each year. But there's a problem with the phrasing in the Chinese text of the paper. We're saying that each year we want to bring in at least 35,000 people. And for each of them, we want them to stay in Hong Kong for at least 12 months. So there's something awkward with the Chinese phrasing. Mr. Shang certainly read the paper very carefully. Next, Mr. Tang Fei. The Labour and Welfare Bureau proposes supernumerary posts to look at manpower in the long term. I want to focus on education. The government used to put education and manpower under the same roof. And once the government gets a sense of what kind of manpower is needed, then it can get on with the work. So how will the LWB work with the education sector on talent so that we can have the local talent to meet our need? The second question has to do with the KPI. The KPI is a way to hold the government to a very clear standard. Otherwise, the KPI is no good. Now, for the demand for manpower, you have to do dynamic analyses. How do we ensure these post holders actually do their job properly? Say you have a projection of a need of 35,000 people, but the real demand is only, say, 20,000 posts. So how can the projection give a real picture? And what happens when there's a discrepancy between the forecast and the real picture? The KPIs are static figures. We don't see the changing circumstances being reflected in the KPIs. And we are worried that the KPIs may descend into some sort of formalities instead. In setting the KPIs and other work, the Labor and Welfare Bureau and other bureaus are involved. We work very closely with the Education Bureau. Once we have the outcome of the manpower projection, that will have implications for curriculum design and also the admission arrangements for education institutions. As Mr. Tang rightly pointed out, manpower policies are not just about attracting outside talent. It's also about giving our local young people an idea of what kind of gaps there will be in manpower to get them to sign up for the relevant disciplines. Now, on KPIs and whether they are dynamic goals, our goal is to attract at least 35,000 people to come here in the next 3 years. We set this KPI last October. At that point, we saw a shrinking of our labor population by 140,000 people. Some of them are top-tier talent. So our target is to attract at least 35,000 people each year. We will keep reviewing our KPIs to see whether changes are needed. At this point, we think it's a suitable KPI. Thank you, Madam Chair. It's my turn now. I have quite a number of questions, so I will adjourn the meeting now and will save my questions for next meeting. When's the next meeting? It's next week, March 22nd, 8:30 a.m. See you, Secretary.